This morning's New Testament lesson comes from the sixth chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke, verses 27 through 38. And again, it's part of Jesus' Sermon on the Plain. If you recall, last week he began with a series of blessings and of woes. Now he kind of gives a follow-up to what he expects. But I say to you, listen. Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. If anyone strikes you on the cheek, offer the other also. And from anyone who takes away your coat, do not withhold even your shirt. Give to everyone who begs from you. And if anyone takes away your goods, do not ask for them again. Do to others as you would have them. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. If you do good to those who do good to you, what credit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. If you lend to those from whom you hope to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies, do good, and lend, expecting nothing in return. Your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, for he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Do not judge, and you will not be judged. Do not condemn, and you will not be condemned. Forgive, and you will be forgiven. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, will be put into your lap. For the measure you give will be the measure you get back. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. After a whole generation of listening to Andrew Lloyd Webber's Joseph in his amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat, we're all kind of inclined to see Joseph as this sweet, lovable, faithful kid. Well, he wasn't like that. Actually, if you start reading the narrative of Joseph, which begins in chapter 37 and doesn't end until the very end of the book of Genesis, chapter 50 or 51, what we find about the young Joseph is that he is not someone we probably would have liked. In fact, well, young Joseph was a pampered, self-centered, arrogant little snitch. He was a spoiled brat who knew that he was daddy's favorite, and he never let his older brothers forget it. The very first time that he's introduced to us in chapter 37, he's 17 years old, and he's out working with his brothers, watching over their flock. Now, we're not told what they did, but whatever they did was either inappropriate or not allowed. And Joseph, he had to run off and tattletale to daddy. It's not surprising that next reference to him is, and his brothers hated him. I imagine, so I imagine so. And then daddy gave him a special coat. It's a coat of either many colors or of long sleeves or highly ornamented. The Hebrew adjective apparently is not well known, so it can be translated in many ways. But in any case, it was a coat that was not to be worn at work. It was the coat of a leisurely man, a man who led a relaxed life, the man who was kind of like, you know, maybe the king walking around among his subjects. And of course, Joseph let his brothers know all about it. Look what daddy gave to me. And we're told they hated him even more. Surprise. make matters worse, you would think somebody who is 17 or 18 years old would have enough sense to know better. He had a series of dreams in which his brothers and his mother and his father all bowed down to him. And of course, he had to tell his brothers, he is definitely not one of the greatest balls in the box. And it's no wonder that they hated him so much that we're told they would not even speak civilly to him. Well, Jacob wasn't terribly bright either. That's his dad. Because one day the brothers were out in the distance watching over their flock. What's little Joe doing? Oh, he's at home relaxing. Yeah. They're working. I got my precious robe on and I'm just chilling out. Well, Dad comes up to him and says, I got a job for you, son. I want you to go out and check on your brothers, see what they're doing, and then report back to me. Be a snitch once more. And off he goes. And so his brothers see him in a distance. They can tell it's him because he's got his precious robe on. And they look around, they look at each other, and they say, you know, we're out here. Nobody can see us. Nobody knows what's going on. Let's get rid of him. In fact, let's kill him. So when Joseph shows up, they strip all his clothes off him and throw him into a pit, and they don't even give him water. And then they rather nonchalantly sit down and have lunch. While he's in the pit crying out, let me out, let me out, give me some water, and they ignore him. But before they have a chance to kill him, or before they decide to just go home and leave him there to starve to death, a caravan passes by and they say, hey, we can make a few bucks, and they sell him to the caravan. And then they take his precious robe, smear blood all over it, and then take it home to Dad, and they lie to him and say, oh, poor Joe, he must have died. And they immediately forget all about him. And meanwhile, Joseph is in Egypt. He's sold again. This time he's sold to Potiphar, the captain of Pharaoh's guard. And he serves Potiphar for a number of years until Potiphar's, shall we say, lusty wife frames him. And he gets him thrown in prison. And so he spends the next several years in prison until the Pharaoh, who hears about him and his ability to interpret dreams, calls him forth. And Joseph comes up, interprets the Pharaoh's dream. The Pharaoh is so impressed, he frees Joseph and makes him his second in command. Now, at the time he goes into Pharaoh's service, he has been a slave or a prisoner for 13 years. This isn't a small period for him. It's 13 years he's been a slave or a prisoner. And he takes the next 7 years preparing Egypt to face the famine that the dream said is coming. During those 7 years, Joseph becomes an Egyptian. He's given an Egyptian name. He's dressed in Egyptian clothing. He speaks Egyptian. And he married an Egyptian woman who was the daughter of the priest of the Egyptian god On. Together, he and she had two sons. The first son is named Manasseh. And we're told that the name means God, and it's nothing Hebrew, Yahweh, or Adonai. It's a generic word. So it could be the god On. After all, that's her dad's job as a priest. But anyway, God has made me forget my hardships and my father's house. I'm always amazed at these old names. Can you imagine somebody going through life, oh, God who made me forget my hardships and my father's house, it's time to eat. But anyway, that's the first son's name. The second son is Ephraim. Again, God has made me fruitful. Joseph became an Egyptian. Then the seven-year famine came. Egypt was prepared, but the nations and the tribes and the people around them were not. 2 years into the famine, Jacob and his 11 sons are starving. So he sends 10 of them into Egypt to buy grain. In order to buy the grain, they have to go through Pharaoh's second in command, Joseph. Now, despite the fact that at this time he hadn't seen his brothers for 22 years, he recognizes them almost immediately. They don't recognize him at all. Of course, why would they? They think he's dead. To them, he's just another powerful Egyptian lording it over them. And not surprisingly, he treated them harshly, treated them severely. First, he accused them of being spies. You're only here to find out our weaknesses so you can attack us at our weak point, our weak moment, and bring us harm. And they go, oh, no, we're not, you know, we're just simple, honest men. We're starving, you know, if we're starving so much, there used to be 12 of us, now there's only 11. One of our brothers died, and our other brother's back home with Dad. So just please, sir, sell us some food. So he agrees to sell them some food, but it's with the understanding or the requirement that they will return. And when they come back, they'll bring the younger brother. To make sure that the guarantee that they're guaranteed to return, he takes the second oldest brother, Simeon, and throws him in prison. And he's going to keep him there until they come back. Then he tells his servants, load up their sacks, their grain sacks, and send them on their way. In the meantime, he replaces all their purchase money in the sacks. And when they're on their way home and they open it, they are really dismayed to find the money. Because now they're sure that he's not just going to accuse them of being spies, but also of being thieves. And God knows what he'll do to them when they return. They go back home, they give the food to Jacob, they tell him what the man has required, and Jacob refuses. He will not send them back. He will not let Benjamin, now his favorite son and Joseph's only full brother, he will not let him go to Egypt. They eat the food, and when there's nothing left, guess what? They're hungry. And they get hungry enough that Jacob relents. All right, you can go back. You can take him, but make sure you bring him back. So when they return to Egypt, Joseph sees his brother, sees all 10 of them there. He welcomes them like long-lost friends. He lets Simeon out of prison. He gets them, make sure they all get bathed. They're all refreshed. He invites them to his house for dinner. And he feeds them all sumptuously. The writer of Genesis points out that he gave Benjamin a little more food. 5 times as much food as his brothers. They weren't upset, though, because everybody were told, ate till they were full. Then Joseph arranges for the sale of the grain. He tells his servants, again, put their purchase money back in their sacks. But then he also gets his silver divining cup. He has it slipped into Benjamin's sack. And he sends them on their way. After they're gone, Joseph suddenly finds out that his divining cup is gone. Aha, those thieves have taken it. He sends his guard out to get them and bring them back. And when they do, he berates them and tells them he's going to throw them all in prison. They're going to stay here forever. And then they start going through. The brothers all say, oh, no, we wouldn't do that. We wouldn't steal. We're honest men. And they go through all the sacks, and they find the cup in Benjamin's sack. And Joseph says, all right, I'll let you all go home, but Benjamin's going to go to jail forever. And that's when Judah once again speaks up and says, oh no, Lord, don't let that happen. Put us in prison, keep us, but send Benjamin home. Our father has already lost one son because of us. They take responsibility for what they had done to Joseph. Our father has already lost one son because of us. If he loses this other son, it'll kill him. So send him home and put us in jail instead. Up until then, Joseph had been toying with them, kind of like a cat that caught a mouse. You know, have you ever seen a cat? The mouse mouse tries to get away and he smacks it. That's what Joseph has been doing with his brothers. Now, they had hated him. They had sold him into slavery. They hadn't cared even a little bit about him. They hadn't given him a thought. And they didn't care what his death or what his disappearance did to their father. Well, now it was payback time. He had the power. He could do whatever he liked with them. But now, seeing how they had changed, he too was changed. At first, we're told he went aside, went in a private room, and he cried quietly because of the changes that occurred. Then he came back into the room, sent everybody else out, and kept his unwitting brothers there. Up until then, he'd only spoken in Egyptian, so they didn't know that he could understand Hebrew. But he sends everybody else out, and he's left with his brothers. And we're told he cried again, this time loudly enough that the Pharaoh could hear him. And at last, he turned to them and said, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" And the brothers, they were scared. Good Lord, it's him, and he's got all the power. What is he going to do to us? And they can't even talk to him. They're so scared. And so he draws closer. And again, he says to them in Hebrew, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sent into slavery." Oh, now they are flat out scared stiff. That's the first thing he remembers. "I'm your brother who you sent into slavery." You can just wait for the other shoe to drop, the axe to fall. I can just imagine them thinking he's had 22 years of being hurt and of being angry and of desiring vengeance. What's all built up in him, and the time has come. What awful things will he do to us? "I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sent into slavery." But surprise, don't be distressed. Don't be afraid. Because you sold me here, because it was God who actually sent me here first to preserve life, to make a place for you and for our father, to give you a good land in which to live. Kissed and he embraced and he talked with his brothers. He tried to make them see his love. Now they had trouble believing it. Who wouldn't? But they did what he said. They sent back to Canaan for Jacob, made the arrangements for him to come to Egypt, where he and they lived in peace and prosperity until Jacob died about 17 years later. And it's only then that we find out that the brothers have been afraid the whole time. They've been going through these 17 years looking over their shoulder, waiting for Joseph to do something to them. Their thoughts are that, well, now that Dad's died, maybe that was all just an act. Maybe Joseph was just waiting to get us when Dad isn't here. And now that he's gone, God knows what he'll do to us. And so they send him a message, and in the message they lied flat out. These guys still haven't grown up. They lied flat out. It was Jacob's last desire that you would forgive us, so please do that. And we're told Jacob cried again. He cried again because after 17 years of providing for them, for helping them grow in prosperity and in peace, they still don't trust him. So he tells them once again, don't be afraid. What happened was God's plan. Don't be afraid. I will provide for you and for your children. And for the next 50-some years, that's exactly what he did until the day he died. Joseph had been changed. His life had been turned upside down. And that's what happens when God enters our lives. Now, the change that came upon him, he really hadn't noticed it. He hadn't really been aware of it. The whole whole story, God is referred to only 10 times. In 14 chapters, God is referred to only 10 times. And then it's always in a very generic sense. We're not even sure if he's talking about the God of Israel. In fact, Jacob never referred to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In those 10 years, those 10 times, he could have been talking about the gods of Egypt. After all, he married that daughter of the priest of On, remember? In any case, Joseph had gone through his life as well as he could, learning, growing, maturing, adapting, compromising, trying to do things his own way. But all the while, God was moving quietly and secretly in the background, putting Joseph where he needed to be. Joseph didn't recognize that until he was with his brothers. And then his desire for vengeance left his heart. He was turned upside down. Now, this took place nearly 2,000 years before Jesus and before the Sermon on the Plain. But Joseph was kind of a precursor of the disciple that Jesus told us to be. Jesus said, love your enemies. Well, these brothers had been his enemies, all right. They'd sold him into slavery. They had forgotten all about him. They lied about it to their father. But when he saw them, he loved them. Jesus said, do good to those who hate you. Well, we're told three times in the book of Genesis, they hated him. They hated Joseph and they sought to harm him. They sold him into slavery. And then they lied to Jacob about it. But he gave them food. He gave them a place to live. He did good to those who hated him. And then Jesus said, bless those who curse you. Well, their actions certainly cursed him. But his actions and his care were a blessing. Those who had brought the curse upon him. And Jesus said to pray for those who abuse you. Well, Joseph's tears when he revealed himself and later when he found out his brothers still didn't trust him, his tears showed how Joseph continued to dwell on them and their well-being, to literally pray for them. And no one told Joseph to do this. There was no preacher or prophet who came to him and said, these are the commands of God. There was no revelatory burning bush moment. There was just a growing awareness that God wanted him and everyone to reflect God's presence. That God wanted us all to love and watch over each other as God had watched and loved and watched over Joseph. Now, Joseph was doing that for his brothers and for the Egyptians whose responsibility he was given. Joseph didn't have anybody to tell him to do this, but we do. God in Christ has come to us and he has told us, has shown us the way. It's important to note that in Jesus' sermon, when he said to love, do good, bless and pray, he didn't give us a series of instructions on how to do that. There's no prescription there. If you're going to do good, this is the kind of things you do. If you're going to pray, these are the kind of things you pray for. One of my professors in seminary, Bob Tannehill, said that we should notice that the language is imaginative, forceful, provocative, and open-ended. It's a language which challenges us to ask ourselves, what can I do to show my love for the one who is my enemy? What can I do to bring a good thing to the one who hates me? How can I bring blessings to the one who curses me? How can my prayer for the one who abuses me bear good fruit? Told to do these things, and he leaves it up to us to figure out how to go about doing it. It causes us to be active, not passive and just accept some new rule, but to go out and do it. not have been spectacular or miraculous. It certainly wasn't for Joseph. But when we really accept Christ, our lives will be turned upside down. They'll be turned upside down so that we can love, do good, and bless and pray for others in ways that, well, frankly, will surprise even us. Have you been surprised lately? Have you loved or done good to or blessed or prayed for someone who doesn't particularly like you? Have you listened to Jesus' call? Perhaps it's time that we all did. And by our actions, help Jesus turn the world.